Today's lesson is entitled, Jesus' Ministry Begins. For the next few Sundays, we'll be studying in the New Testament from the Gospel of Mark. We have 3 points in today's lesson. The first one is John the Baptist prepares the way in the first 8 verses of chapter 1 of Mark. Point number 2, ministry beginnings. Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 20. Number 3, manifesting unequaled authority. Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 39. The central truth, Jesus began his ministry with miraculous signs. In a golden text, Jesus said unto them, "Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." Mark 1 and 17. Our whole lesson today will be found in the first chapter of the book of Mark. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I ask that you will be with us in this meeting, to guide our thoughts and to help us to better understand what the writer was talking about and how he introduced Jesus even to us who are Gentiles. We ask for your anointing, and I thank you again and again for the word. It is precious to us all. These I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. In speaking of the book of Mark, most church traditionalists will declare that John Mark is the author of this book. In the New Testament, he's called John Mark. He had quite a beginning and went with Paul on one of his evangelistic tours, and for some reason decided he would turn around and go back home. Just about did him in with the Apostle Paul. He thought he had ought to have a little bit more spunk than that. But as he matured, he became a great powerhouse for the kingdom of God, and we are so fortunate to have his writings. This writing has been placed between 50 to 70 A.D., so we're in that first 100 years of A.D. It's interesting to find that John Mark was related to Barnabas. In the 4th chapter of Colossians, he writes, "Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, sends you his greetings, and also Barnabas, cousin Mark, about whom you received instructions. If he comes to you, welcome him." That was the writing of the Apostle Paul. But Mark also worked with Peter in his ministry. The book of Mark could possibly have been the first record to be written of the good news of Jesus Christ. He tells the account of Jesus' ministry in a story form, and he writes it especially for the believers. His goal is to show that Jesus and his followers who are struggling with trying to remain faithful in the middle of trials and suffering will find their greatest help and their strength in the Lord Jesus Christ. Mark uses 2 storylines in his book, and the first one has to do with who Jesus is. Faithfully, John Mark presents him as Christ, the Son of God, and he refers back to the writings of the Old Testament, and especially he finds some help from the book of Isaiah concerning Jesus and his ministry, his death and his coming, burial and resurrection. So We conclude that the cross of Christ is not a contradiction of Jesus' status as God's son. We understand that it was prophesied from the Old Testament that he would come and that he would be crucified, he would be placed in the tomb, and he would be resurrected. He came to do the Father's will. The Jews' idea of a Messiah was quite different from this. They were looking for someone who was a great political figure. They were looking for someone very handsome, very picturesque, and they were looking for someone who would free them from the regimes that had come to oppress them as Jewish people. And even the disciples had to learn who Jesus really is. The second storyline in the book of Mark focuses on how Jesus' special followers, or his apostles, respond to their teachers. So we know the first storyline has to do with who Jesus is. Wasn't what they expected, but he came in the will of God and did his job as the Savior of mankind. And the second storyline is how his followers responded to him. And it's easy to understand that they don't totally understand who Jesus is. And it's hard for them to understand that serving is more blessed and more important than greatness. And they struggled over these issues. But Mark put these two storylines together for our benefit. We're 2,000 years down the road from this writing. And if the followers who were so close to Jesus continually heard him teach but don't fully understand what God is doing, then we today should be more inclined and challenged to study and to understand what is actually happening in that period of time and how it affects us today. We may, as we get into the ministry and into the work of God, we too may face hostility and resistance when we teach and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. For illustration concerning that particular subject, I would like to relate a story around the time of the late 50s, in the early 60s. There was a young man named Sidney Goodwin, his young bride and infant child, who arrived in the continent of Africa as first-time missionaries. Sid's father, Homer Goodwin, a veteran missionary, was also working in the same location, preaching the gospel to a very special people. On this particular occasion, service had been announced and preparation was made to start the meeting. Sid was to light the plant that would produce light, but it exploded and he was killed. His wife continued in ministry, and she wrote the beautiful poem, which she entitled "Traveling on My Knees." That poem was read by Assemblies of God people everywhere. The call of God does not guarantee that one will escape pain, but we do understand the words of an old song: "This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me to heaven's golden shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore." For our first topic today, it is entitled "John the Baptist Prepares the Way." Subtopic A, John the Baptist Coming Prophesied in Mark chapter 1.
The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Question, why did Jesus need someone to prepare the way?
The book of Mark presents the Son of God with all the power to perform everything that God does. We notice the opening statement, the beginning of the good news about the Messiah, Jesus, the Son of God. This is a clear statement that the gospel of Jesus Christ is the good news. The good news that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. No other son was born as he was born. Jesus was born of a virgin. No man had anything to do with his birth. He was conceived by the Holy Ghost, and he is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. He is a very definite, most beloved, the Son of God. Acts chapter 4, verse 12 declares that there's no other name given under heaven whereby men must be saved, and that name is Jesus. The prophet Isaiah and other prophets way back in history mentioned that there would come a Savior who would deliver God's people from sin and shame, and that a messenger would precede him. That messenger was John the Baptist. He was a relative of Jesus, a little bit older than Jesus, and he preceded him. John was a hard-hitting, divinely taught enemy of sin and hypocrisy. He championed righteousness, and we can classify him for men of history like Moses and Samuel and Elijah. John the Baptist preached to people that were spiritually dead. The leaders were spiritually blind. They made up their own religion to a certain extent by adding their own laws to the law that had been given by Moses. Jesus came at just the right time, and several Old Testament prophets had prophesied of his coming. When he did come, he was not really accepted by his own people. As I said before, they were looking for somebody that was really classy, that was really picturesque, and that had a personality that would draw people to him. But Jesus was Jesus. He was come to this earth to bring salvation. So the answer to the question,
why did Jesus need someone to prepare the way?
Well, the people of Israel had been through a lot. They had come through the time period of being a captive in a strange land, absolutely uprooted from their own homeland and taken to a foreign country where there were foreign gods, foreign people, foreign language. Every custom was foreign to them. And when they had been there about 70 years, then gradually they began to filter back home, were allowed to come back home. But they were in not in the same kind of condition that they were when there were prophets like Isaiah that were prophesying to them. And so they had to have a prophet's voice, somebody that could prepare the way for the Messiah to come amidst all of this strangeness that the people of Israel were encountering at this time. So the answer to the question, was somebody had to prepare the way. Point B, John's work described Mark chapter 1.
And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. And this was his message: "After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Question: how did John the Baptist prepare the way for Jesus Christ?
When John appeared on the banks of the Jordan River, he was a character like they had never seen before in Israel. You remember that his parents were quite old when he was born, and he was named John. His father had been, his voice had gone from him for a time until actually he spoke the name John. Was to be this man's name. He grew up in the wilderness country where it's desert, it's rocky, there are all kinds of thorns and just not very habitable habitation. And he began to baptize on the Jordan River. He had a strange garment. He wore a camel's hair garment, and he had a skin tied around his waist. And when he went to the Jordan River and began to baptize, that was a totally new concept for the people of Israel. Those who came to John the Baptist came because they had been acquainted with the promises of God through the prophets. They confessed their sins and they were baptized. He called for repentance. He asked them to repent of their sins before they were ever baptized. And so as they begin the process of wading out into the Jordan River and being dunked under the water, brought a totally new concept to the people of Israel, as I already mentioned. I'd like to tell you that being placed underwater by a preacher will save no one. It's Jesus that saves. That procedure is only to demonstrate what had already previously happened when they confessed their sins and then came to be baptized. Water baptism shows the world that we are followers of Jesus in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. John the Baptist was a prophet. He was a powerful prophet. Even his diet was different. He ate locusts and wild honey. Probably the locusts were dried. I just can't imagine anybody eating those, but he did. That was his diet. His diet was different. He was dressed differently. He was on a mission, and he did not allow any of the distractions that were around him to hinder him from what he felt was to be the forerunner of the Messiah. He spent his time doing what God had called him to do, and that was to preach and to baptize. Let me just add a little thought here. Perhaps it would be wise if we followed his example by not trying to do things that interest us if they distract us from what God has called us to do. We might be surprised at the number of Christians who are saying, I'm just waiting around for the Lord to tell me what to do. I've been saved for about 15 years, and I have no idea what God wants me to do. But the Holy Spirit shows us a life, a prayer life, a life of dedication, a sense of purpose. God does not call us from darkness into light just to sit on the bench every Sunday morning. He does not deliver us from habits, addictions, and from the craziness that we were in just to claim, I don't smoke anymore. I don't drink anymore. I don't fornicate anymore. Here is the purpose that God has given to every believer, and that is to know Him and to make Him known. We make Him known through the life that we live, through the conversations that we have, through the caliber of work that we perform, through the faithfulness that we portray. And we do this wherever the Lord has planted us. When we are about the Father's business, then God will be glorified in our lives. John the Baptist made the profound statement that he baptized in water, but there was one coming after him who would baptize the believers in the Holy Spirit. We definitely need the power that accompanies the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And now, even more so as we see into the future, we absolutely must have God's power to deal with demonic forces that are unleashed in our world. The answer to the question,
how did John the Baptist prepare the way for Jesus Christ?
John the Baptist recognized that his job was to announce that Messiah was coming. So he didn't get involved with a lot of political or social endeavors. He spent his time doing what God called him to do, preach confession and repentance for sin, in fulfillment of the prophecy that had been given many years ago, and baptize in water those who were believers. Point number two is entitled Ministry Beginnings. Our subtopic A is Baptized and Tested.
At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. Question: is it possible to live so close to God that when he speaks, we hear him?
Jesus was baptized in the Jordan, and his consecration immediately after by the Holy Spirit was the close of his private life and the beginning of his public life. Up to this time, he had rather lived in obscurity in the city of Nazareth. His father was a carpenter. He was recognized by the people of Nazareth as the son of Mary and Joseph. He had brothers and sisters. He knew the neighborhood kids. But after he was baptized, a heavenly anointing filled him with supernatural powers that he had not previously displayed, preparing him for the office of Messiah that was promised to the fathers. The baptism in Jordan had mysterious accompaniments. There was a heavenly dove that was involved, and there was the voice of God that was heard. That marked the dividing line in his life. In the holy symbol of the dove, which was the pledge on Noah's day that wrath had turned to mercy, we're reminded that peace could be won back to the troubled soul by the grace of God. Jesus' baptism was the birth hour of Christianity. Crowds had thronged to hear John the Baptist, but he was only the messenger or the herald of the kingdom of God. He could not act as its head. The Messiah who was to come would offer salvation to the world. Immediately after Jesus received the word from heaven, the same Spirit drove him into the wilderness for 40 days, where he was tempted by Satan. Laid on him was the burden of giving himself to meet and to overcome the prince of darkness. He would bear the sins of the world as the spotless lamb, the sacrifice. He would withstand the opposition and the hatred of men. They would mock him. They would be indifferent and they would be insensible. He would die on the cross as the crucified one. He was sent to the wilderness. The wilderness that we speak of is not a place where there's trees and grass and streams and beautiful things. It's a very place that's very harsh and hard. The sun beats down on the desert in the area around the Dead Sea and in the place of Masada and the place where the scrolls were found at the turn of the century. There are a lot of rocks. There's a lot of heat. Absolute torturing heat. Nothing there that is really conducive. Maybe some animals could find a bit of grazing from what little scant of growth would be produced, but it was a wild, a rocky, a hot, sandy desert country inhabited by wild animals and poisonous serpents. There's one called the asp. It buries itself underground, covers the ground over its head. And when a traveler walking through the country, unbeknownst to the danger ahead of him, happens to step in the vicinity of the asp, it will spring out from under its covering of sand and dirt, bite the traveler, and in just a few hours, if he cannot get help, he is dead. That's the kind of place that Jesus was sent for 40 days in intense preparation for Calvary. The prince of darkness had oftentimes tried to discourage him and to overcome him. The Bible says he was tempted in all points, like as we are. Temptations come, and when we overcome them, they make us stronger. But if we are not careful, we will allow the devil to tempt us with things that will draw us away from our consecration to the Lord Jesus Christ. The hardest of the temptations that Satan produced was probably when he was most exhausted and the weakest in his 40 days of being tempted. doing without food for 40 days is a long time. But he won. He won. The desert served its purpose. The crisis passed. Angels came and ministered him. He had left Nazareth, an humble Galilean villager, to visit John the Baptist, and he returned the consecrated Messiah, ready to become the Lamb of God that would take away the sins of the world. I'm talking about Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who had been prophesied to come from the foundation of the world. It was in the plan of the Father. He was human like we. Of course, he still had his God qualities, but he laid them aside to live as we do. And he passed every test. He was to become the Savior of the world for whosoever would believe in him. So the answer to the question,
is it possible to live so close to God that when he speaks, we hear him?
He speaks through his word. That's the Bible. He speaks through the trials of life. He speaks through a still, small voice. He speaks through good advice of godly people. He speaks through dreams and visions. Absolutely, it is possible to live close to God and to hear him when he speaks. Subtopic B of our second point is proclaiming and calling.
After John the Baptist was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat preparing their nets. Without delay he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Question: Jesus' message was the kingdom of God. What exactly is the kingdom of God?
John the Baptist was sent by God to tell the people that the Savior was coming, just as Isaiah had prophesied in the 40th chapter and the 3rd verse. The voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord and make his path straight." In Malachi chapter 3, "I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me." So we know John the Baptist was come to prepare the way for the Messiah. He faithfully followed God. He baptized many people. He told them to ask God to forgive them of their sins. Jesus also came to be baptized, though he had never sinned. John obeyed his request. He was later put in prison by Herod Antipas, the son of Herod the Great, because he reproved him for divorcing his wife and marrying his brother Philip's wife. Her name was Herodias. She's quite famous among Bible believers. John's imprisonment was in the castle of Machaerus on the eastern shore of the Dead Sea. And he was later decapitated by Antipas. As John the Baptist's public ministry ended, Jesus' public ministry began. The tyrant Antipas had silenced the voice of the one that proclaimed the coming of the kingdom of God. But the one whom John the Baptist had introduced was at hand to take up the message when that voice had been silenced. Isaiah, the son of Amos, had once seen a vision of Jehovah in the temple. These are some men that had been called of God in the Old Testament. He recognized his call as a prophet. The Spirit came on Amos, who was the shepherd, as he followed his flocks on the lonely pastures. He heard Jehovah call to him, forsook his hills, and became a shepherd to Israel. Down through the ages, men and women have been called to carry the message of God's love and his provision of salvation. John the Baptist, murderer, opened the door for the Messiah of Israel to pay the price for the salvation of men and women, of past and present history. We get to the verse 16 through 20 of chapter 1 of the book of Mark, and Jesus begins developing a team of helpers. He walked along the shore of Galilee until he found two brothers, Andrew and Simon. We know him as Peter. They were fishing, and Jesus called to them and said, "Come and follow me and become fishers of men." They left their nets and began to follow him. The pattern is repeated with two more brothers, who were James and John, who also left their father and the nets with their fishing boat to follow the Messiah. In that first century of the new AD, fishermen in boats worked on the Sea of Galilee. They caught fish in their nets and they salted them or they dried them, and then they were sold. Jesus called his disciples to be fishers of people instead of fish. The answer to the question,
Jesus' message was the kingdom of God. What exactly is the kingdom of God?
The kingdom of God is a realm in which a king, namely Jesus Christ, exercises his power to act and control. It had been prophesied, but Christ has now come. Admission into this kingdom, the new covenant, is repentance and faith. We come to the third topic of this lesson, entitled Manifesting Unequaled Authority, our subtopic A, by word and by action, verses 21 through 28 of the book of Mark.
They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then, a man in their synagogue who was possessed by an impure spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly. "Come out of him." The impure spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. Question: what is the difference between religious authority and spiritual authority?
Jesus made his headquarters in the city of Capernaum. That is a city on the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee in Galilean territory. And Mark records the story of Jesus' visit to a synagogue. Synagogue is a place of Jewish worship of Jehovah. He went there on the Sabbath day and he taught. Jesus taught in that synagogue. The synagogue probably dates back to the time of the captivity. And there are really no specific proportions in the building of the synagogue like there was in the temple. They did choose the highest place to build the synagogue. And if it was not taller than everything else around it, they would erect a tall pole on the top. They were so constructed that when the worshipers went inside the synagogue, they faced the city of Jerusalem. At the end, there was a chest containing the book of the law. Toward the middle of the building was a raised platform with a pulpit in the middle, in the center. A low partition 5 or 6 feet high divided the men from the women. Instruction was the object of the synagogue. Expounding and teaching the law was the great business of the synagogue. The priest had no privileges there. They belonged in the temple. The synagogue was a place where they could learn. The leader might ask any suitable person to speak, and different ones came to speak in the synagogue, and that allowed Jesus to speak there as he did on this occasion, on many occasions. It was what he taught and the way that he taught it that amazed his listeners. Doctrine was the word of God, and the scribes taught tradition, even though they were supposed to be experts in the law of Moses. It was in the year 1988 that I was privileged to be in Jerusalem and visited a synagogue. It was a tall building, the way I remember it, had an upstairs. The men were downstairs and the women all were seated upstairs. You could look over the balcony and see what was going on. There was a pulpit there. It was a very solemn occasion, the time I visited. The one in Jerusalem, and the people were very solemn who had come to learn at that particular synagogue. I was with a group of ladies, and when we arrived, there wasn't anybody sitting upstairs, so we just chose some seats and sat down. We noticed little tiny pieces of paper that were attached to the seat with some Hebrew writing, but we did not read Hebrew, so we did not know what those little tiny pieces of paper had to say. Before long, there were a group of Jewish ladies came in, and they were not happy. We had got their seats, and they had paid for those seats for this particular time. And so we asked where we might be able to sit, and they said they didn't know. We could just stand out in the hall. It was kind of an interesting experience. But it was a synagogue, just like recorded in the book of Mark. They'd been with the Jewish people for generations. In the particular meeting that we are studying, in this third point, Jesus is speaking. He has been allowed, and he is expounding the word. Something unusual happened in that meeting. There was a demon-possessed man that was present in this particular meeting. I know that people are still demon-possessed today. We don't talk about it a lot, but I definitely know that there are human beings that have demons, and they do things that they know better they would not do in their own right mind, but they are driven by this power that is inside them. the same Jesus that cast out the demon of that particular Sabbath day is able to cast out the demons in the year 2021. His power is far greater than what the devil has, far greater. Satan has more power than we do. We are humans. But I thank God for his wonderful presence and the power of the Holy Spirit that we have come to so appreciate as valuable in our lives. But in this particular meeting, the lead demon spoke out for itself and for others. And he just spoke out in an interruption in the meeting. He said, "Have you come to destroy us?" They resented the fact that the Christ had come into their domain because they knew his power and they knew who he was. Demon spirits know who Jesus is, but the religious leaders didn't know. Jesus rebuked the demon and told it to come out. Now just listen closely, and I think you might be able to imagine the screech of fear of Christ that interrupted that meeting that day. Fear of Christ and fear not to obey him. He came out with a shriek. Folks were speechless and they were asking, "What happened here?" They realized that they had just witnessed a power greater than demon forces. That story traveled all the way to Jerusalem and infuriated the religious leaders. The answer to the question,
what is the difference between religious authority and spiritual authority?
Religious authority is human authority, and spiritual authority is supernatural authority. Subtopic B of our third point is healing and praying.
As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. Question: why didn't Jesus take advantage of the excitement of the people to build up his popularity?
When they arrived at Peter's home, Peter's wife's mother had been struck down with a violent attack of the local fever for which Capernaum was well known. Jesus took her by the hand and raised her gently, and the fever was gone. She was able to help prepare the meal for her household and for the wondrous guest. At sunset, Sabbath was over, and sick people began to crowd into the house. Jesus healed them all: fevers, convulsions, asthma, wasting consumption, swollen dropsy, shaking palsy, the deaf, the dumb, the brain affected. And besides all of that, many that were possessed with devils. That one being the worst symptom of the despairing misery and dark confusion of the times. The sight of so much misery crowding for relief touched Jesus, and so he spoke. He spoke words like this: "Hold thy peace and come out of him. I say to thee, arise, take up thy bed and walk. Be it to thee according to thy faith. Woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. Be of good cheer, my son. Thy sins are forgiven thee." He spoke, and for about 3 years, he spoke words just like this all over the land of Israel. After resting for a while throughout the night, he rose in the dark to find a place to pray. He had a mission to reach the lost of the family of Abraham. He chose to not stay in Capernaum because so many other places needed the gospel before his blood would be shed for the salvation of all who would accept his gift, Jew and Gentile alike. And the answer to the question,
why didn't Jesus take advantage of the excitement of the people to build up his popularity?
He came to do the Father's will, and nothing could keep him from accomplishing his Father's will. Our lesson for next Sunday will be Jesus confronts religious leaders, and we'll go to Mark chapter 2, and we will discuss and discover the truths and the beauty of the second chapter of the book of Mark. God bless you. Have a great week.